Good evening, everyone. I am super, super excited. Tonight is quite possibly one of my all-time favorite topics, and Pastor Phil has an exciting little demonstration for us that he's going to get into later. I'm not going to spoil it for him, but I'm really looking forward to what he is going to be sharing with us tonight. But before we get started, I want to invite you to join me as we invite our Creator to join us. So join me as I go to my knees, if you would bow your heads and close your eyes. Father in heaven, I want to thank you so much for your love and for your kindness. Thank you, Lord, for choosing to love us, for choosing to join us tonight. Lord, as we dive yet again into your word and into the book of Revelation and discover prophecy, discover another promise, a beautiful promise that you have outlined in your word for us, I ask that you open our minds, open our hearts. May we be like sponges soaking up the truth of your word. Father, I ask that you be with Pastor Phil, bless his lips, speak through him in a mighty and powerful way tonight. Father, thank you for your love and kindness. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, as always, join me, lift your Bibles, and join me as we say our phrase that we say every night. Are you ready? If it's in the Word of God, we want it. Say it with me again. If it's in the Word of God, we want it. If it's not in the Word of God, we don't want it. Amen. Amen. I don't have the clicker. Alrighty, so we have our library enrichment. Many of you guys have been going through the Bible school as well as the resource center. I just want to remind you of that as well. And also the Bible school. The questions, we have a number of questions that were entered over the past couple of nights, and we're going to be answering actually three of them in just a second. And I'm super excited for these answers because where are they found again? And the Word of God, and the Word of God. But tonight I want to highlight two items that are in the Resource Center. You can go there tonight and browse through them and look at them, and they're really, really powerful. First, I want to tell you guys about this magazine, Signs of the Times. Signs of the Times was an article that was a periodical, a magazine that would repeat. And there was a lot of awesome articles back in the early 1900s. But you know, the information is still relevant for us today because where was it found? The information, the lessons were found from the Word of God. And so I want to encourage you to dive into these magazines and to discover the truth that God has. Steps to Christ, probably one of, outside of the Bible, probably one of my favorite books. This is a short little book that talks about how to build a relationship with Christ. Now, I have gone through it a number of times, and it has step by step taken me every day into a closer relationship with God. Every time I read it, I find out more about God's love. There's stories and lessons on how to pray, how to build your relationship with God, how to have faith, and many others. And so I just want to encourage you to look into the book Steps to Christ. And I even use it today. So, I mean, I didn't read it today, but I use it nowadays. So it's really powerful. All righty, next, our children's program. Again, we have our children's program downstairs. Not too young is too young. Our question time. I'm going to invite Pastor Phil up here as he joins us. We have a number of questions we're going to be asking him.
Okay, let's see. Am I on? I don't think I'm on. I mean, you can hear me, right? But now,
you should be able to really hear me. Can you hear me? Good evening, everyone. Good to see you. Pastor Jericho, what are our questions for this evening?
All righty. I have a number one, so I'm going to go from easy to more difficult.
Okay.
The easiest question, at least I think, did the Jews go through everything they went through because they did not believe in Jesus and that he was the Son of God?
It's a good question. I want to clarify something. We talked about a couple of evenings ago when we were studying when the judgment began, that Daniel chapter 9 talked about how there was a dispensation, there was a time that was cut off for the Jews, Daniel chapter 9, verse 24, 25, and onwards. But we also saw that after 34 AD, the gospel went to the Gentiles. So here's what I want to make clear. The first is that as individuals, anyone who is of Jewish descent can be saved by the grace of God. Amen? Secondly, as a nation, because they rejected Jesus, yes, that is why it happened. Let me show you from the Bible. Go with me to Daniel chapter 9. Let me show you what the Bible says. Daniel chapter 9, verse 26. So notice what the Bible says here. Daniel chapter 9 and verse 26. And when you're there, if you'd let me know by saying amen. Notice what the Bible says. Daniel chapter 9 and verse 26. And after, I hear some pages turning, I'll give you a few minutes to get there. Daniel 9, 26. The Bible says, after 62 weeks, Messiah shall be cut off, but not for himself. Remember we studied this? What does the cutting off of the Messiah represent? It represented the what? The crucifixion of Jesus Christ. So the Messiah shall be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end shall be with the flood, till the end of the war of desolations are determined. Then he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. We saw that this confirmation of the covenant was Christ coming and confirming the covenant he had made with man to save them. He confirmed the covenant with many for 1 week, but in the middle of the week he shall bring an end to sacrifices and offerings. We studied this. What happened in the middle of the week? 3.5 years after Christ was baptized, he was what? Crucified. And in the middle of the week, he shall bring an end to sacrifices and offerings, and on the wing of abomination shall be one who makes desolate, even until the consummation which is determined is poured out on the desolate. Here's what Daniel is pulling together. The crucifixion of Christ. After the crucifixion of Christ, there would be desolation that would come upon the nation of the Jews. And here's what happened. In 70 AD, we saw this early on last week. In 70 AD, the city of Jerusalem was destroyed, and it was a direct result of the rejection of the Messiah by the Jewish people. However, there were Jews that accepted Jesus Christ. They heeded his warning in Matthew chapter 24, and they made it out, and not a single Christian, Jew or Gentile, died during the siege of Jerusalem.
All righty. Thank you, Pastor Phil. That was a great question. Again, the answers come where?
From the Word.
Straight from the Word of God.
Next question.
Our next question, why didn't the law appear until Exodus 20? How could sin exist before then?
Good question. Go with me to Romans chapter 3 and verse 20. Rephrasing the question, the law came, if I understood it correctly, the law came at Sinai. Was the law really in existence before Sinai? And here's the answer from the Bible. Romans chapter 3 and verse 20. I love to hear those pages turning when you're there, if you'd say amen. Romans 3:20, notice what it says. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, no flesh shall be justified in his sight. For by the law is the what? Knowledge of? If there is no law, is there any knowledge of sin? What does the Bible say? By the law is the what? Knowledge of sin. Now go with me over to Romans chapter 5, verse 13. Notice what Paul says again. For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed where there is no what? If there is no law, can anyone say, I sin? They don't know what sin is unless it's defined by the law. 1 John chapter 4 talks about how sin is the transgression of the law. So go with me now to the very beginning of your Bible, Genesis chapter 4. And you can see this repeated in a number of places. We'll just hit two main points. Genesis chapter 4 and verse 6. Genesis chapter 4 and verse 6. So the Lord said to Cain, why are you angry, and why has your countenance fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, what's the next word? Sin lies where? at the door. Now, you remember the story. Cain and Abel have been having a tiff because Abel brought the sacrifice that God asked for. Cain brought the sacrifice God had not asked for. And Cain said, I want God to just honor what I bring. And Abel said, I will do what God asked me to do. Cain becomes angry with his brother because God accepts Abel's offering and rejects Cain's offering. And God says to Cain, sin lies at your door. Now here's the question. If there is let me rephrase this. If there is no law, would Cain have known what sin is? According to the Bible, how do we know what sin is? By the law. So right here in Genesis chapter 4, there had to have been a law that was known by Cain and Abel. Well, someone says, well, why didn't the Bible put it in there? The answer is quite simple. Moses wrote the first five books of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. Those first five books Moses wrote. And so he, in shorthand, refers to the law here because Moses understood what Paul explained, that sin is defined by the law, sin is given through the law, and breaking the law is sin. Moses understands that. And so Moses, the same author, in the second book, puts the law that had been in place from the very beginning before even our planet was created. Are you following me? Does that make sense? One more place, Genesis chapter 13. Genesis chapter 13, and I believe it's verse 13. Oh, I got to move. I'm taking too long. We got an exciting topic tonight, and I want to make sure we have time for it. Genesis chapter 3 and verse 13. But the men of Sodom were exceedingly wicked, and are you there? Genesis chapter 13, verse 13. Do you see it there? Reading, following along with me. But the men of Sodom were exceedingly wicked, and what's the next word there? Sinful against who? The Lord. Now, how could God say these people are sinful if the sin is not defined by the law and it wasn't coming for hundreds of years? Do you understand what I'm saying? So it's very simple. The law has always been in place. It was reiterated at Sinai. Moses wrote it down then, but it's always been there. Next question.
Alrighty, our last question in reference to Acts chapter 9, verse 13 through 17. And if you want to go ahead and read that, and then I'll ask the question.
Well, go ahead and ask the question, and then we'll go and look at it. Acts chapter 9. Go ahead and read the question.
Acts chapter 9, verse 13 through 17. Why do we use the name Jesus and God instead of other names, Yahweh and Yahshua.
Yahshua and Yahweh. This is a very good question. And whoever put this in,
yes,
thank you for putting it in. It's a great question. Go with me to Acts chapter 9, and let's read these verses that are referred to here in verses 15 through 17. Are you there in Acts chapter 9? Notice what the Bible says. Verse 15, but the Lord said to him, this is the story of Ananias when he came and anointed the eyes of Paul, and the scales fell from Paul's eyes. But the Lord said to him, go, for he is a chosen vessel of mine to bear what? My name before the Gentiles, kings, and the children of Israel. For I will show him how many things he must suffer for my name's sake. And Ananias went his way and entered the house, and laying his hand on him, he said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you came, has sent me that you may receive your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. And immediately there fell from his eyes something like scales, and he received his sight at once, and he rose and was baptized. It's an amazing story what's happening here. But I think the question is focusing in that Paul was to take God's name to the Gentiles. Let me ask you a question. What does the Bible, in fact, God himself, say is his name? Go with me to Genesis chapter 33. Exodus chapter 33. Exodus chapter 33. We're going to be going down to verse 18. Exodus chapter 33 and verse 18. When you're there, if you'd say amen. It's an amazing story. Moses wanted to see the glory of God. Verse 18, Moses says, and he said to him, please Show me your glory. Verse 19, God responds, then he said, I will make all my, what's the next word? Goodness pass before you, and I will proclaim the what? Name of who? The Lord before you. I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. The name of the Lord is the expression of the character of God, of the compassion and the goodness of Jesus. Because when God passed before him, he exclaimed that his goodness and his mercy was there. What does that mean? Paul, in his character, carried the compassion and the love of Jesus. Now, there's another dimension to this that dives into the original language. We actually do not know how to pronounce the Hebrew name for God. Because the Hebrew scholars, as they wrote the vowel, all they put in was no vowels. They only put in consonants, and they also didn't put in how to pronounce them. And the reason why they did it, if you go back and you look at the ancient history and the language, is they believed that no one should ever be able to truly pronounce God's name. It was too sacred to put in writing. So we actually don't know how to pronounce it. And you can look this up. You can go ask a Jewish scholar. They'll tell you, we don't actually know how to pronounce. We have a pronunciation that has been supplied, but the original pronunciation has been lost to time and to the fact that they felt that no sinful lips should pronounce the name of God. So in answer to the question, that's why we use what is commonly used, just like it's Jesus in English, it's Jesus in Spanish, and there's a number of other languages I don't know that use the various names of God. But I believe that God in heaven someday will tell us the original pronunciation, and at that point, I can't wait to use it.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Phil. That was an awesome answer. Again, if it's found in the Word of God, we know that we can trust it. We know that we can believe it.
Amen.
This time, we'll invite our health presentation up.
All right. Well, good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Good to see you all out here again tonight. In this session, we're addressing the growing epidemic of what we're going to call hurry sickness. So this presentation is hurried, worried, and buried. Do you ever feel like that person on the screen? Well, sometimes I do. So there's a Chinese proverb that says, we hurry, we worry, we bury. Sometimes it seems like that's all there is to life, especially when we're really busy. Many of us are able to get a lot done, but without balance, we've come down with this hurry sickness, and so we suffer physically, emotionally, and spiritually. Being overly busy and burnout can make even the little things in life seem overwhelming. Sometimes you're going to bed and it's like, I still have to brush my teeth. I just don't feel like I have the energy to do that. That is like the smallest thing we have to do in our day, right? But when we're overly busy and burned out, even those little things that literally take 3 minutes, as recommended by your dentist, less if you're normal like most of us, even those little things can get dropped off. So even doing too many good things can crowd out life's best and most important priorities. So let's take a breath and let's look at some important principles for striving for balance. We need balance. So here are a couple principles. Pare down or you'll wear down. Now, we tend to be a society that finds it very hard to say no, especially if we don't feel like we have a good reason to. If I can do it, I should probably do it, because there's no reason not to. So then we load up our schedule and we're like, oh good, my schedule's too full. I'm sorry, I can't do it, I'm already booked. Right? That happens to me. Take time for your physical health. Take time for your mental and spiritual health. These are things that all help us to maintain balance in our life. And you might find that you're strong in one area. You might have no problem saying no, which is wonderful. But maybe physical health is suffering because of it. Maybe we don't get our time for exercise, or maybe we grab fast food on our way out the door or after we get out the door. So sometimes we're strong in one area, but we need to concentrate more in another area. So here are some ways to help take care of ourselves. Nutrition is a big one. Caffeine, let's see, I just went too far. Caffeine, sugar, and alcohol all rob the nervous system of real strength and lead to fatigue, cravings, and addiction. So this can be a huge trap, because when we're worn out, the temptation is to use stimulants to keep us going, when really being worn out is our body's cry for rest, not to be artificially stimulated even more. And it ends up drawing on our reserves until we really crash. So some ways that we can get that energy is by eating high fiber vegetables, fruits, beans, and whole grains. These can all help provide that longer lasting energy. It helps calm the nerves and it helps improve mental clarity. Also, and we just talked about this recently, taking time for exercise. Daily exercise reduces anxiety and fatigue and increases our energy, both mental and physical. So yes, you can, we can. But the question is not, will I exercise today? The question is, when and where will I exercise? And for me, often the question is, what kind of exercise will I do? Because it's so easy, you wake up and it's like, oh, what exercise am I gonna do today? I'll do it this morning. But it really is cold outside, so I don't feel like walking. And I am not in the mood for lifting weights, because then I'd have to warm up and lift weights and cool down and stretch. So I think I'll just skip it and I'll do it tomorrow when I figured out what's better. So I actually find, and I'm not promoting any specific program, but if you can find a program that works for you and have it scheduled out so you know what you're doing every day of the week, that's what helps me actually get out of the bed to do it, is I know what I'm doing and don't have to think about it and make a decision about it on the spot. But just like exercise is important, rest is often overlooked, but it's so necessary. Chronic lack of sleep swamps your system with stress hormones and saps physical and mental energy. So getting our sleep helps us to have that energy we need. And we talked about a little bit about how we can get better sleep. One of the ways is to establish a sleep routine, something that you do every night. Slow down your evening pace. Now, I know we're all prioritizing these meetings, which is amazing, but this isn't going to go on forever. This isn't normal life. And so when you're not as busy in the evenings, you can try to slow down a little bit and not be going until you drop into bed. Leave media alone at night. The light emitted from our devices actually turns on our brains. It wakes up the brain and makes it harder to sleep. Now, something you can do to help, it's not the solution, but there is software you can download that turns it to a yellow light instead of a blue light. So that's good, because blue light is very energizing. But even so, it still affects our sleep patterns. So just making it a habit to turn it off before bedtime, turn off our screens, can help us get better rest at night. Don't eat late. Now this one, my husband and I don't usually eat late, but last night the ancient grain sample was so good. And I had a couple because I was starving. And I was up last night for like an hour, just kind of like tired but not sleeping well. And that's something that Phil and I have found consistently, is that we don't usually eat much at night, if at all. And when we do, it's just light, so our stomach can digest it before we go to bed. But if we eat something heavier, and definitely if we eat it later, closer to bedtime, our sleep is not as good, and we wake up kind of with that hungover, like, ugh, feeling like I really don't want to get out of bed. Whereas normally, if you eat very light fruits or toast, something that's really easy to digest, and you don't eat too late, you wake up feeling pretty energized and ready to go for the day. Nix caffeine and alcohol. These are both things that affect our rest on a regular basis. Caffeine during the day and late eating at night can stimulate the wake centers of the brain and disrupt deep levels of sleep that are so important for immune health, memory, and true rest. But it's not just our physical health that's important. It's important to take care of our mental health as well. So, and I just want to ask, we don't have much time, but just a couple of you, what do you love to do that refreshes your mind and body? It's good to hear what other people have. What do you love to do that refreshes your mind and body? Cook? Here's a true chef. Yes. What's that? Run after kids. That'll wake you up. Those that are with kids the most stay young longer. Take a break from cooking and running after kids. Different stages of life. So whatever it is for you, try to incorporate just a little bit of that in your life. Mentally refreshing diversions like hobbies, social time, reading, and recreation are like mini vacations for your brain and body. When you've been taxing your brain so long, to get a diversion is really important so you don't get unbalanced, which affects your emotions, your mental health, all of that. Now, if you're experiencing persistent chronic health conditions or depression, it's always important to consult with your healthcare provider. We're providing general information here, we're providing principles, but there's not a one-size-fits-all because God has created each of us unique and different. And so our bodies respond to things differently. The same exercise for me would not be a good exercise for you, and vice versa. So it's important to maintain a good relationship with our healthcare providers. Now, positive connections with others also helps to improve mental, physical, social, and spiritual health. And we're going to tie this all together here in a minute. But it's important to take time to grow our relationships, and that is time that is well spent. Even if it's while you're driving, just calling up a friend or a family member, just keeping in touch and having those social connections is so important. Take time for your spiritual health. God wants you to trust Him to guide you safely through life's busy challenges. Now, I find that it's so beautiful. God created us, and He knew that we would have a need for all of these things. He knew that we would have a need for cutting things out of our life at times. He knew we would have a need for social relationships. He knew we would have a need to spend time with Him. And so at creation, God set aside a special day of rest for friendship, for time with Him, and for getting away and having a diversion from what usually occupies our minds. And in Genesis, it says, God blessed the seventh day and made it holy because He rested in it from all His work, which He had created and made. So God created this special gift for rest and for relationship so that we wouldn't be overly burned out, so that we wouldn't be so worried about life. We could just kind of put things aside and not worry about it for a time. In Exodus 20, it says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. The seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it you shall not do any work. Because God knew that we would have a tendency to overwork. He knew that we would have a tendency to become unbalanced. So He gave us the gift of time. It's a special place in time to enjoy with God, with people, and it's a time to rest. And He invites us into His rest. I just love that God cares for not only our spiritual health, but our physical and our mental and emotional health as well. And you see, God is always calling his people to spend time with him. Mark 6:31, come away by yourselves to a quiet place and take a rest for a time. So we don't have to be hooked on busy, living the life of the hurried, the worried, or the buried. God has power, promises, and a plan for our lives. Will you accept God's invitation tonight to come apart and rest a while? If you want to commit to making just some time, just a little time this week to spend alone with God, will you just raise your hands with me and say, Lord, I want to spend that time with you. I want to give up my life of being hurried, worried, and buried and take that time with you. Amen.
Oh, when shall I see Jesus and reign with him above, and shall hear the trumpet sound in that morning, and from the flowing fountain drink everlasting love, and shall hear the trumpet sound in that morning. Oh, shall glory, for I shall mount above the skies when I hear the trumpet sound in that morning. Gird on the gospel armor of faith and hope and love, and you'll hear the trumpet sound in that morning. And when the combat's ended, he'll carry you above, and you'll hear the trumpet sound in that morning. Oh, shall glory, for I shall mount above the skies when I hear the trumpet sound in that morning. Our ear shall hear with transport the host of heaven sing, and shall hear the trumpet sound in that morning. Our tongue shall chant the
look forward to that day when we hear the trumpet sound. How about you? In fact, Saturday night, we're going to be doing a deep dive into exactly what happens at the second coming, how that takes place, what are the events around it. You won't want to miss Saturday night. Good evening, everyone. It's good to see you all. Can you believe it's Wednesday already? Has this day, week been flying by for you? Well, our topic tonight is Jesus on religious tradition. Tonight we're going to be doing a part one of a two-parter that comes tonight and then Friday night. And I want to encourage you, after tonight, you won't want to miss Friday evening because they come together as a package. Tonight we're going to look at what the Bible teaches. Friday night we're going to do a deep dive into what happens what has happened over the last 2,000 years within Christianity. And you're going to want us to put these two pieces together, and it's going to explain a lot of what's going on right now at the end of time. So tonight's topic, Jesus on religious tradition. Before we begin, would you bow your heads with me for prayer? Oh, Father in heaven, as we come before you this evening, we thank you for the privilege we have of gathering here in this sanctuary to study your word. We thank you for the promise that where two or three are gathered together in your name, which we are, you promise to be here in the midst. I thank you for the angels that are pressing close, and for the power of your spirit that is here to guide us into the truth of your word. We ask that tonight, Jesus will teach us what he wants us to know. Hide me behind the cross. May Jesus come alive to each one of our hearts and minds. In his name we pray. Amen. Jesus on religious tradition. When it comes to questions on the origin of life, there really are only two answers. We either were created by the hand of an infinite and powerful being, or we came about by chance. Recently, I've been studying with a gentleman who is wrestling with the question of the origin of life. He is currently, well, he was an atheist. He's now an agnostic, but the Lord is really moving in his life, and he's seeing the evidences. But one of the things we've been wrestling with is, do we come about by chance? What is the origins of who we are? And one of the things that I have found as I've been studying this is all across the universe and around our planet, from down to how DNA divides in the cell and how our pieces of our bodies are put together, to the vastness of the universe that we inhabit, God has left his fingerprint throughout creation. For example, if you take DNA, there's an amazing book called Genetic Entropy. You can look it up later. It's very fascinating. It's written by a top geneticist who has become a young earth creationist because looking at the DNA code that every one of us here have, you cannot push the age of DNA back more than about 6,000 to 9,000 years. Well, guess what? The Bible says man was created about 6,000 years ago, just as the Bible says science bears out. God has left his fingerprints throughout the universe. We find it in throughout the cosmos, from the infinite of space down to the minutest atom. Everywhere we look, we see the infiniteness of God. In fact, if you go to the book of Revelation, there's this amazing picture where John is caught up to the throne room of God. Go with me to Revelation chapter 4, and we see that God is not infinite in his ability to create, but he inhabits an infiniteness in the universe. Revelation chapter 4, and when you're there, if you'd let me know by saying amen. Revelation chapter 4 takes us into the very throne room of God. It's an incredible scene that John sees in Revelation. He sees the glory and the majesty of God. In fact, I want to invite you, we're going to come down to verse 4, but I want you to start off in verse 1. Revelation chapter 4, are you there? Notice what it says. After these things I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was like a trumpet speaking with me, saying, come up here, and I will show you things which must take place after this. Immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne sat in heaven, and one sat on the throne. And he who sat there was like a jasper and a sardis stone in appearance. Imagine what John sees in vision as he sees the infiniteness and the power of God. High and lifted up is the King of the universe. In majesty and glory he is there. The jasper stone and the sardis somewhat try to describe it. There's a rainbow, the Bible continues on, around the throne in appearance like an emerald. And around the throne were 24 thrones, and on the thrones I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white robes, and they had crowns of gold on their head. God takes John the Revelator up into heaven, and he shows him the majesty and the glory of God. And I wish we could see it. I look forward someday to seeing it And as John continues on down, he comes to this amazing proclamation from the 24 elders. I want you to notice what the elders say. You are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory, honor, and power. Why? Read it with me. For you created all things, and by your will they exist and were created. Why was God worthy of glory, honor, and praise? Because he created everything. The reason why we worship God is he's our first, our creator, and secondly, our redeemer. It is his creation that leads us to worship him. Before you existed in the womb of your mother, you existed in the mind of God. Before you came forth into this world, God was in the process of creating you. You have a purpose for living. You have a reason for existing. You are held in the infinite mind of God. Jesus Christ is revealed in Revelation. His majesty is revealed in Revelation. His glory is revealed in Revelation. And as we come to the central part of what we've been studying over the last number of nights, I want you to notice what John the Revelator says as we look at the message in the center of Revelation. This message we've been studying, we studied it Saturday evening. We studied it Monday evening. We studied it last night. And tonight we're going to look at another dimension that comes out of this message given by the first angel in Revelation chapter 14 that goes to the entire world. I want you to notice what this message says. Fear God and give glory to him. We studied that Saturday evening. For the hour of his judgment has come. We studied that Monday evening. And when did God's judgment hour begin? Anybody remember? 1844. What was the date? 1844. For the hour of his judgment has come. And what's the next word? Worship him who made heaven and earth, the seas and the spring of waters. The part I want us to focus on this message that goes out to the world right now is the part that talks about worship him. There's a message that goes to the world calling people back to worshiping the Creator. How do we worship the Creator who made the heavens and the earth? How does he remind us of his creative power and of his majesty and of his authority? Revelation is the book that brings us to an understanding of this. We can understand the book if we understand how the book begins. Revelation takes us to how everything ends, and to understand how it ends, we need to go back to understand how it begins. How do we worship the Creator? So go with me to the book of Genesis, and I want you to notice what God has done to help us remember him as the Creator. Genesis chapter 1, right there at the very beginning, we see the revelation, we see how God reveals himself to mankind. And right there at the beginning, Genesis chapter 1 and verse 1, someone follow along with me as we read. The Bible says, in the beginning, God what? Created the heavens and the earth. Before there was an earth, there was God. Before there were humans, there was God. Before there was a beginning, there was God. When the beginning came into existence, God came into existence. In the beginning, God created. And I want you to notice what God creates. He starts off by creating light, and then he begins to divide the light from the darkness. And it's as the earth comes forth from the hand of the Creator, and each day more detail is added until everything, an intricate detail that we know today, is created in six literal days. The beauty of what God creates is incredible. He speaks, and our earth comes into existence. I speak and nothing happens. God speaks and a world and a universe comes into existence. He speaks and flowers of every variety and grasses and trees carpet the landscape, bringing exquisite beauty on every half. I love gardening, by the way. I can't wait to see what God the Master Gardener created. He speaks, and the sea is begin filled with life, teeming with every variety. He speaks, and animals are created. And then God comes to the crowning act of his creation. You find the story in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. For most of us, this is review, but I want you to picture what is happening. God, the Creator, gets down on his hands and knees. Everything else that God has created, he speaks and it happens. But when it comes to this second to the last act of his creation, God gets down and gets very personal. He takes the dirt and he begins to fashion man from the dust of the ground. I can see God fashioning the arms. I can see him fashioning the hands. I can see him fashioning the hair and the torso and the legs and every detail. And then God bends down and breathes into Adam's mouth the breath of life. And the Bible says Adam became a living soul. Notice what it says here in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 and 27. Let us make what? Man in our image. Continuing on, in the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. We are not in the image of some primordial soup that accidentally came about. We are created in the image of God. Then the Bible says, thus the heavens and the earth and all the hosts of them were finished. God has created everything we see. But there's another dimension of what God creates. And I want you to notice it here in Genesis chapter 1. And we're going to look in verse 2, we're going to look in verse 8, and we're going to look in verse 13. I want you to notice what it says. Verse 2, reading aloud, following along in your Bibles, notice what it says, reading with me. So the evening and the morning were the first day. Genesis chapter 1 and verse 2. When you're there, if you'd say amen. Let's read it again. So the evening and the morning were the what? First day. Then God does something else. He then fills the second day, and we come down to the end of verse 8 of Genesis chapter 1. Notice what the Bible says. So the evening and the morning were the what? The second day. Verse 13, following along in your Bibles. Genesis chapter 1, verse 13. So the evening and the morning were the third day. Continue on in verse 19. Notice what it says. So the evening and the morning were the fourth day. You're starting to get the pattern. Keep following along in chapter 1, verse 23. So the evening and the morning were the fifth day. Then we come down to verse 31. Then God saw everything he made, and indeed it was good. So the evening and the morning were the what? Sixth day. We talk about what God created, but I don't want you to miss this point. It's absolutely vital we understand this. God didn't just create what we see. God also created how time works. Every day of our week, God created. Think about it with me here for a moment. What do we base the month off of? The cycle of the moon. What do we base our yearly cycle off of? Somebody tell me. Our cycle around the sun. What do we base the day off of? The rotation of the earth. What do we base the weekly cycle off of? Creation. Jesus. One of the evidences that the Bible is true is that the weekly cycle, the only basis for the weekly cycle is because God created it, period. That's it. And the entire world follows the same days that God created. Now, here's what's very fascinating. What did God create after the sixth day and the creation of man? Go with me to Genesis chapter 2 and verse 1. I think my slides got ahead, but I want you to notice this. Verse 1, thus the heavens and the earth and all the hosts of them were finished. And I want you to notice here, verse 2, and we're going to read it off the screen. And on the, reading aloud with me, seventh day God ended his work which he had done. And he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had done. Then God, keep reading, blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all his work which God had created and made. I want you to notice what is happening here. God is creating a seventh day to the weekly cycle. Do you see it? Day one, God created. Day two, God created and filled. Day three, God created and filled. Day four, God creates and fills. Day five, God creates and fills. Day six, God creates and fills. And then God creates day seven. But day seven is different. God doesn't fill day seven with creation. God fills day seven with something different. God fills day seven with the presence of his blessing and his spirit. You see, the seventh day Sabbath given at creation was to be God's perpetual reminder of our roots. We find in the Sabbath the reminder that God is our creator. We find in the Sabbath the reminder that he is our savior and our redeemer. In the Sabbath, we are to be reminded this seventh day that God set aside that he is our savior, he is our creator, and he is our Lord. Let's notice what God did to the seventh day. We found this in Genesis 2, verses 1 through 3. Notice what God did on the seventh day. God, what does it say? Bless the seventh day. Notice what else? God, what's it say? Sanctified the seventh day. And God, what's it say? Rested on the seventh day. Well, let's unpack what each one of these mean. The first is that God blessed the seventh day. God blessed the seventh day by making it an eternal sign of his powerful creation and infinite love. And I want to talk to you about what was unique about the seventh day. And I know someone's been wondering what is up with all of these, with this up here. And what I want to show you is an illustration that I saw a preacher use many, many years ago that really helped me understand what was happening. These are symbolism of the 7 days of creation. We have Sunday, first day, second day, third day, fourth day, fifth day, sixth day, or Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Each day God filled. But when it came to the seventh day, God didn't create animals, people, or plants. That was all done. God filled the seventh day with a blessing. A blessing that has extra sweetness and goodness in it. Are you with me? Now, you could drink from any one of these, but which one's going to taste the best if you like grape juice? Oh, I love grape juice, by the way. This day has the greatest taste in it. Now, I don't mind water, but if I want that extra sweetness, where am I going to go? To the day that God blessed. Can a human bless a day? Can I make anything blessed, yes or no? Only God can. And the Creator blessed the seventh day. And then the Bible says that he sanctified the day. What does sanctified mean? Sanctified means to be set apart, to be made special. It's different than anything else. Let me use an illustration. When I got married, my wife and I were set apart for each other and for nobody else. Are you with me? Now suppose, thank you for saying amen, honey. Amen is right. Oh, I thought it was. Thank you, dear. I heard it from over there. I assumed it was you. Amen. But let's suppose that my wife's sister, Katie, after we got married and we're in the car and we're getting ready to take off on the honeymoon, I look over and Katie jumps into the front seat and says, okay, let's go. What am I going to do? I'm going to say, no way. You're not the person set apart for me. Are you with me? God set the seventh day apart for us. And the word there, set apart, sanctified, is the same word that the Bible uses when it talks about how a husband and wife, how a wife is sanctified for a husband and vice versa. Set apart for working together. When you're married, you are set apart by the grace of God for life, for each other, to be sanctified for each other. And the seventh day is a day that God has set apart for His people. It's a day that He has put... That's really good. A special blessing in. It's a day that He wants us to know that He cares about us. The Sabbath comes from creation. It was put in place long before, by the way, there were any Jews or there was any other type of people. Who is every one of ours father by biologically? Every one of us can trace back to who? Adam. There were no different racial groups back then. He contained all of our DNA at that point in the mystery of how DNA works. It was long before any one of these things were in place. The Sabbath was a sign in the Old Testament. It is a sign we will see in the New Testament of the people who love Jesus with all their hearts and are willing to build a relationship with Him because they want to be close to Jesus. Well, someone say, hold on. Wasn't the Sabbath put into existence at Sinai? Well, go with me to Exodus chapter 16. I want you to see something very amazing. In Exodus 20, the law was given in Sinai. But if you go earlier in time, so Exodus 20 is here, and we're going to go back sometime before the law was given, and you go with me to Exodus chapter 16, and you go down to verse 26, I want you to notice what happens. Something very fascinating. Exodus chapter 16 and verse 26. Are you there? 6 days you shall gather it. Now, what's happening here, let me give you a little background. The children of Israel are in the wilderness, and they've been begging for food. And so God promises to send them food. It was called manna. What is it? What manna means is literally, what is it? And so God is sending this manna to them. But He's giving some very specific instructions. It's interesting that He's calling them to keep a day, the seventh day, before even the law had been given. Why? Because the seventh day had been in existence from creation. It wasn't new. It was very old. It was a time that God set apart to build a relationship with His people. Exodus chapter 16, let's read it together. 6 days you shall, what's the next word? Gather it. But on the seventh day, the Sabbath, there will be what? None. The angels weren't even going to bring manna on Sabbath. It was another time. In verse 28, the Bible says this, and this is very important. Now, the Lord's, because here's what was happening. The children of Israel, there were some that were going out on Sabbath and trying to see if there was manna still on the ground. And the Lord says this. The Lord said to Moses, how long do you what? Refuse to keep my commandments and my laws. Now, the Ten Commandments hadn't been given from Sinai, but as we talked about at the beginning, God's law had existed all the way from creation. It was just reiterated at Sinai. The Lord said to Moses, how long do you refuse to keep my commandments and my laws? The Sabbath had been there from the beginning. When God gave the law and included the Sabbath in the law, God didn't write it with anything. He didn't write it in parchment or sand. God wrote it in stone. God didn't put it on a sand of a beach to be washed away. He didn't put it in parchment to be burned up. God wrote it in stone because He wanted it to endure forever. It was to last forever. Let's go look at this commandment that's reiterated in Exodus chapter 20 that the Israelites were reminded of that God gave in Eden. Notice what the commandment says. Remember, what does God say? What's that first word highlighted in yellow? What's the word? Remember. Why do you think God says remember? When my mom wanted me to take out the trash, first thing she would say is, Phil, will you take out the trash when you go out to school or whatever? And I'm like, yeah, Mom, I'll do that. And then as I'm walking towards the laundry room to head out, what is my mom about to say? Phil, remember to take the trash out. Why did she say remember? Because she knew I had absolutely forgotten. Why does God say remember? Because he knows that we're prone to forget. He knows that humanity forgets the importance of a relationship with Jesus. The Bible says, remember the what? Sabbath day to keep it holy. Does it say to make it holy? No. Can we make anything holy? No. To keep it holy, because who made it holy according to the Bible? God made it holy. Why did God say, remember? We already talked about that. Verse 9, continuing on, 6 days you shall what? Labor and do all your work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall do what? No work. Let's talk about which day was the seventh day. If you were to look at a calendar and you were to count down the days of the week, I think most of us would know this, but I want you to notice if you had Sunday is which day of the week? First day. Monday is the second day. Tuesday is the third day. Wednesday is the fourth day. Thursday is the fifth day. Friday is the sixth day. And which day is the seventh day? Every single week, no matter what the numbers are on the calendar, the seventh day of the week is what we normally refer to as Saturday. The day set apart by God for his people to worship with him. Now notice this. Why does God in the Ten Commandments say we're to keep the Sabbath? Notice where the Ten Commandments point back to as the reason for keeping it. For in how many days? 6 days, the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested when? On the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath and hallowed it. Right there, contained in that fourth commandment, God points back to creation, and he says, he blessed it, he sanctified it, he hallowed it with his presence. There is a blessing in the Sabbath for you. The Sabbath was never exclusively a Jewish institution. It was given to all of humanity before there were Jews or Gentiles. It has existed from creation all the way down through time. It has always been there, and God calls us to keep it as a day especially set aside for him. I want you to notice Isaiah chapter 56, verses 6 and 7. Notice what God says. Everyone who keeps from defiling the Sabbath, I will bring to my what? Holy mountain. Now let's talk about this. What does it mean to defile the Sabbath? If I take this glass and I start pouring in the water from the rest of the week, I bring in the things that I would normally be doing, the activities I would normally be doing, what's going to happen to this grape juice? It'll become nasty. It'll become diluted. You understand what I'm saying? And so God says, don't bring other things into this day. Keep it set apart. Keep it specially for that time that we spend together. Everyone who keeps from defiling the Sabbath, I will bring in to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. God talks about those who keep the Sabbath as the ones who are receiving a special blessing from him. Throughout the Bible, the Sabbath is God's what kind of sign? Everlasting sign for all of his people of his love and his goodness and his graciousness. Notice Ezekiel chapter 20 and verse 12. Moreover, I also gave them my what? Sabbaths to be a sign between them and me, that they may know that I am the Lord who sanctifies them. What does the Bible say the Sabbath is? It's a sign. It's a sign of what? It's a sign that Jesus changes my life. You know, I want to talk a little bit about the Sabbath and what it means. Right after God created mankind, God created the Sabbath. Why did Jesus create the Sabbath? Because Jesus wants a relationship with you. Jesus cares about you. And he wanted right there at the very beginning, right after he created Adam and Eve, the next day, God said, is special for you and I. You know, when you get married, what's the first thing you do as a couple after you're married? You go on your what? Honeymoon. Why? Because it's important to build that relationship. The Sabbath, God said, yours and my relationship is so important. I'm going to create this palace in time just for us to spend together. It's a time to build a relationship with God. Don't let anyone misconstrue what the Sabbath is. The Sabbath is a special gift from the King of the universe that he says, this is my time to spend with you and build a relationship. Sabbath was at creation. It is reiterated at Sinai. It was written by God in stone. But I can hear someone say, Pastor, didn't things change in the New Testament? Doesn't the Sabbath no longer count once we get to the New Testament? Well, let's go look at what the Bible says. Go with me to the New Testament and let's see what Jesus did with the Sabbath. Luke chapter 4 and verse 16. Take your Bibles and turn there to the book of Luke. Luke chapter 4 and verse 16. Notice the example of Jesus. I love what Jesus does. So he came to Nazareth where he had been brought up, and as his what? As his what? Custom was, he went into the synagogue on which day? The Sabbath. And he opened the book, he found the place where it was written, and he read to them. He stood up to read. What was Jesus' custom? To go to church on Sabbath. Jesus kept the Sabbath. In fact, in Mark chapter 2 and verse 27, when he was challenged on Sabbath keeping, Jesus responded with this very important phrase that I think has often been forgotten. Christ speaking here, Mark chapter 2 and verse 27. And he said to them, the Sabbath was made for who? Does it say the Sabbath was made for a Jew? It says it was made for man. It was a gift from the Creator himself for every single one of us here. Man was not created for the Sabbath. The Sabbath was created for us. The Sabbath is a sign that we worship Jesus exclusively, that we love him supremely, and that he is everything to each one of us. It's interesting, even in death, Jesus kept the Sabbath. I want you to notice this. We'll actually look at this a little bit later in our sermon this evening as we finish our study here shortly. But even when Christ died, remember, Christ was crucified on what day of the week? Anyone tell me? On Friday. He rested on what day of the week? And he began his work of intercession for man on what day of the week? With the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Even when he was in the tomb, he was resting. John chapter 14 and verse 15. We read this last night, but I want you to see it again. Read it aloud with me. If you love me, keep my commandments. We don't keep the Sabbath to be saved. We love Jesus, and so to build a relationship with him, we keep the Sabbath. We love Jesus, and to receive a special blessing from him, we spend time with him on the Sabbath. In fact, after the death of Christ, or before the death of Christ, in Matthew chapter 24, Christ was with the disciples, and we studied this opening night, actually, Matthew 24, signs of the second coming. But there's something very interesting, because 40 years after Christ died, he still expected his followers to be keeping the Sabbath. Notice what Christ says in Matthew chapter 24 and verse 20. You can turn there if you would like, or you can read it off the screen. Matthew chapter 24 and verse 20. Notice what Christ says. And pray that your flight may not be in the winter or on the what? Sabbath. Now, someone may say, Pastor, didn't Jesus change the day? And I would submit, if Christ expected his followers to be keeping the Sabbath 40 years after his death, about 40 years, just under 40 years, then the Sabbath was still important to Jesus Christ. Do you hear what I'm saying? Because he wants a relationship with you. Jerusalem was destroyed in 70 AD. And Jesus expected his followers to still be keeping the Sabbath in AD 70. Well, someone may say, hey, hold on, time has been lost. The calendar's been changed. Well, actually, if you look at it, time has not been lost. Let's look at the biblical answer to this. The Sabbath was stated at creation and restated in the Ten Commandments. But let's carry on down. We have a connection from creation to the Ten Commandments. We have a connection from the Ten Commandments to the life of Jesus. And actually, in the New Testament, we are told which day was the Sabbath. Let's notice this in Luke chapter 23, verses 54 through 56. Notice Luke chapter 23. I'll let you turn there in your Bibles. And we are going to be able to see from the New Testament which day is the seventh day Sabbath. Notice here, verse 54, talking about the crucifixion of Christ. That day was a preparation day, and the Sabbath drew near. What day did Christ die on? We said it earlier. What day was it? It was Friday. And the women who had come with him from Galilee followed after, and they observed the tomb and how his body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and fragrant oils, and they rested on the Sabbath according to the commandment. Now on the, what's that say? First day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb, bringing the spices which they have prepared. We have a progression of the order of events. Friday, preparation day. Saturday, the Sabbath day. And Sunday, the first day of the week. Christ died on Friday, rested on Sabbath, and was resurrected on Sunday to begin his work for mankind, according to the Scriptures. Christ has given us, and so we see here in this beautiful order of events that from creation down to the day of Christ, the Sabbath is still on Saturday. And we can know from that day till now that that is continued on. The Sabbath of the Bible and creation is still found on the seventh day of the week. In fact, someone may say, don't we observe Sunday in honor of the resurrection? And I would like to submit to you that Christ told us how we honor the resurrection of his. Romans chapter 6, verses 3 and 4. Notice what the Bible says. Or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into, what does Paul say? His death. Therefore, we are buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. The way we celebrate the death and resurrection of Jesus, according to the Apostle Paul, is when we were baptized into Jesus Christ. And as we come up out of those watery graves, we are restored into the image of Jesus. We come alive into a new life in him. And that is the way, the symbol that Jesus left to remind us of the Sabbath. Of the death and resurrection of Jesus. In over 140 languages of the world, the word for the seventh day of the week is Sabbath. This is absolutely amazing to me because, again, it is an evidence that this comes way back at creation. You can go through the Greek, the French, the Spanish, the Portuguese, the Italian, the French, the Germans, the Russians, the Polish, the Persians, the Hindi, and the Arabics. Each one of them, you can see there, have a word that's very similar to Sabbath, and the meaning is exactly Sabbath. And Sabbath means a day of rest. From every part of the world, these languages, whether no matter what their background is, their word for the seventh day is a day that means a day of rest. The Royal Observatory in Greenwich, England, received a letter. Someone was asking, has the weekly cycle ever changed? And they responded, and I can share the document with you afterwards if you would like. The weekly cycle has never changed. It is always continued on, as far back as they can tell, in the same order every week. Jesus and the apostles kept the Sabbath. Go with me to Acts chapter 17, verses 1 and 2. Here, as we're wrapping up here soon. Acts chapter 17, verses 1 and 2. I want you to notice what the example of the apostles was. Now when they had passed, are you there in Acts chapter 17 and verse 1? Amen. Now when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollyon, they came to Thessalonica, where there is a synagogue of the Jews. Then Paul, as his what? Custom was. In other words, this was something that Paul did all the time. He did every week. Went into them, and for how many Sabbaths? Three Sabbaths, reasoned with them from the Scriptures. Now, what's amazing is Paul continually is reasoning with them as his custom was. He kept the Sabbath for 3 weeks in a row. Well, someone would say, of course he is. He's meeting with the Jews. Well, come back with me to Acts chapter 13 and notice a very fascinating story about what happens. Acts chapter 13 and verse 42. Notice this very fascinating story. So when the Jews went out of the synagogue, Paul has been preaching to the Jews on that Sabbath. And when they finished, the Jews leave the synagogue. The Gentiles beg that these words might be preached to them the next Sabbath. Now follow me through with this very closely. It's Saturday. It's Sabbath. Paul is in a Jewish synagogue. He has just preached a message about Jesus. The Jews, who are offended by this, walk out. The Gentiles are ecstatic to hear that there's a Savior for them. So they come up to Paul and they say, hey, we want to hear the same thing. Can you preach this to us the next Sabbath? Now, if Paul was keeping Sunday, and that Sunday was for the Gentiles, all Paul needed to say is, don't worry, just come back tomorrow. I'll explain it to you. But that's not what Paul does. Notice what happens. On the next what? Almost the whole city came together to hear the word of God. Acts chapter 16 and verse 13, we see again that the apostles kept the Sabbath, followed the Sabbath, and found the blessing in the Sabbath. Here, Acts chapter 16 and verse 13, on the Sabbath day we went out of the city to the riverside where prayer was customarily made. And we sat down and spoke with the women who were met there. Paul went on the Sabbath day and was looking for people to minister to and was praying with them and worshiping with them. This was Paul's habit. This was the apostles' habit. You see, the revelation of Jesus Christ calls us back to true worship of Jesus. Revelation chapter 14, verse 17, or Revelation chapter 14 and verse 7. Take your Bibles and turn there very quickly with me if you would. Revelation chapter 14 and verse 7. Reminding us of what we've seen. Saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment has come. And what are the next words? Worship him who what? Made heaven and earth, the sea and the springs of water. The call in Revelation is a call to come back and worship the Creator. Well, someone may say, what about Revelation chapter 1 and verse 10? I was in the Spirit on the Lord's Day. Someone says, aha, Pastor, that the Lord's Day, isn't that Sunday? Well, actually, if you look in the Bible, the entire book of Revelation, according to the Bible, was given on a Sabbath. How do you know? Well, let me show you. What day is the Lord's day? Matthew chapter 12 and verse 8. What does the Bible say? For the Son of Man is what? Lord, even of the Sabbath. Mark chapter 2 and verse 28. Notice what the Bible says. Therefore the Son of Man is also, what does it say? Lord of the Sabbath. In Luke chapter 6 and verse 5, the Bible says, the Son of Man is also Lord of the Sabbath. The Lord's day is the Sabbath. One of the greatest prophetic books found in the Bible, the one that contains a triple blessing, don't miss this, was given to John in about 90 AD on a Sabbath day. The apostles kept the Sabbath. The Sabbath of the Creator God in Genesis is the Lord's Day of the book of Revelation. In Revelation chapter 14 and verse 12, we've seen this verse a number of times, but it comes down because it's describing the type of people we want to be. Notice what the Bible says. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who, what? Keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. The Sabbath. Given at creation, given at Sinai, kept by God's people, kept by Jesus, kept and honored by the disciples, was a sign of God's creative power found at creation, is also kept by us in heaven. Notice this. Isaiah chapter 66 and verses 22 and 23. You can turn there or read it off the screen. Talking about the new earth someday, I want you to notice what the Bible says. For as the new heavens and the new earth which I will make shall remain before me, says the Lord, so shall your descendants and your name remain. And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one, what does the Bible say? Sabbath to another, all flesh shall come to worship before me, says the Lord. I can imagine them coming from every dimension of the known universe, traveling light years through, whether it's teleportation, or whether it's through portals, or whether it's through some incredible technology, whatever it is, God gives His creatures throughout the universe the ability to travel, and every single Sabbath of the weekly cycle, they come, and we worship before the Creator. Every person is invited. Everyone will be there. I want to be there. How about you? Can you imagine what it's going to be like worshiping when Jesus gets up to preach the sermon? Oh, it's going to be a sermon you don't want to miss. And he stands there and he begins to describe what he did to save you. He describes the work that he went through to save humanity, the condescension that he went through to save mankind. And as we hear the wonders of that majestic, melodious voice, we throw our crowns down in adoration. Because Jesus has paid it all. I have a question for you. If God created the Sabbath to build a relationship with His people, He reiterated the Sabbath on Sinai. Jesus kept the Sabbath. His disciples kept the Sabbath long after His death. We'll keep the Sabbath in the new earth. Do you think that it would be good for us to keep the Sabbath now? Satan is at war with God. He does not want us to know and remember Him as our Creator. He does not want us to know or remember that we can have a relationship with Him, and especially He doesn't want us to build a relationship with our Lord and Savior. And so He hates the Sabbath because He doesn't want you to be close to Jesus. Friday night is part two of this message. We're going to do a deep dive into the prophecies of Daniel chapter 7 and in Revelation that tell exactly what happened with the Sabbath and why the Christian world keeps Sunday. You won't want to miss it. It's powerful. But every head bowed, every eye closed, it's time for the appeal. Where are you? For some of you, this may be the first time you've even heard that Saturday is a gift from God. Some of you may have heard of Saturday before, and you have a lot of questions now. There's a lot of, it's unsettling inside. But tonight, there's two parts to the appeal. The first is this. It's all about Jesus. Tonight, do you want to raise your hand? Don't raise it yet, because I'm going to tell you what you're raising your hand for. And just say, Jesus, I love you. And I will do whatever you ask because I love you. You are not saying that you're going to, you may have a lot of questions tonight that you need to go home and wrestle with. Go wrestle, go study. But tonight you want to reiterate, wherever God takes you with this, you want to reiterate, I love Jesus with all my heart. And if you do, would you raise your hand? You want to say, Lord Jesus, I love you. I love you with all of my heart. Don't be ashamed, just raise it high. Praise God for all those hands going up. Put them down. The second is this. You may have a lot of questions. There may be things that are swirling around your mind. I'm going to challenge you to go home and study the Bible. Don't go and look at what other people say. Look at what Jesus says. If you want to commit tonight to continue studying the Bible, to find truth, would you put your hand up again? Say, Jesus, I'm going to study your word because I want truth. Hold it high. Amen. Let's pray. Father in heaven, you've seen our hands. You know our hearts. We've seen and studied in your word that the seventh day was created by you. We've seen your word say that there's a blessing in the seventh day. We've seen your word talk about how there is a day sanctified and set apart for us, your people. We've seen that you want to build a relationship with us on the Sabbath. Oh, Father, there may be someone here that's got a lot of questions. I pray that you'll bring peace to their mind and guide them in your word. There may be someone here that's struggling with the implications, but I pray that they'll just trust you with all of it. You've seen our hands. We love you, Jesus. You've seen our hands. We want to study this. You know our hearts. Come close to each one here tonight and guide them in this journey of discovery. May your word come alive in every way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm going to remind you that tomorrow evening, we're not here tomorrow evening, Friday evening, we will be looking at Jesus on the Antichrist. A powerful study into some of the very fascinating prophecies. God bless each one of you. Thank you for being here and for your studying. And I look forward to seeing you back here Friday night.